greatest privilege I know of in sharing my life is when God deems it time to send our pastors to us, Bill and Nancy Sharp. We got saved under their ministry. And served them for a number of years. Mistreated them for a number of years. You know how it is. Just as you're growing and you don't always do everything right. But they're such people of grace. And they just, you know, we were sheep and they were shepherds. And they've loved us ever since. And then for them to come, this is not the first time, but for them to come, I like to think they drove 4,000 miles just to see us. I know that's not quite true, but it's pretty true. Amen. But I want you to give them a warm Las Vegas welcome, Dr. Bill and Nancy Sharp. Praise the Lord. One more thing. We're not going to dismiss the children because I want them to hear our pastor. Okay? And you're going to love it. It's going to be fun. I know you'll miss Sister Camille, but you know, she understands. And, okay, all right. Let's go.
It is so good to be here with you today. And we have traveled. It's actually about 2,500 miles from here to our house. But we did a lot of ups and downs across the country as we've come out. So that's where the 4,000 miles has come in, put on a lot of those extra miles. But it was worth it because it's been wonderful. And to see what's going on. We love to see what's going on around the world because for over 50 years, we pastored churches and we were in church every Sunday of our life. And if we went on vacation, we would visit. But that's the only time we ever saw what anybody else in the world was doing except on television. So it was very interesting when we started being able to do that and to just get a feel. Because, you know, we've heard so much about we're living in the last days and the Lord is coming soon. But I don't think sometimes we don't really realize how soon the coming of the Lord is. When I was a child, we thought the Lord was coming at any minute. I mean, we actually really lived like the Lord was coming. I accepted the Lord at 8 years old, and I've never looked back. And the Lord has blessed us. I, of course, never knew I'd be in the ministry. My family, none of them were in the ministry. And when I went into it, it was all raw territory and new to both my husband and I. He had never been in the ministry. He had nobody that was in the ministry in his family. So we relied on advice from teachers and beloved people that we worked with through the years. And we learned and we gleaned. And it just seemed like everything kept growing inside of us. And you realize that there's a big world out there. And you realize that there are more out there than there are inside. And that we've got to do our job, don't we? We have to pray because, you know, the Lord, he's working. He's sending revival around the world. Overseas, people are getting saved. And the Bible says, you know, of course, in the last days, everybody's going to hear the word of God. Well, there's probably not too many in the world that have not heard the word of God now. Not even in the darkest Africa. It used to be that we would hear, oh, way back there, you know, the missionary went in and nobody had ever been in. Of course, Coca-Cola had already gotten there. But nothing else had ever gotten there. That's the truth. And they would go in the darkest Africa and see these people that had never seen white men. You know, that had never had anybody come and tell them anything. And they'd go back there and minister to them, and they were just open and hungry because they had their things that they worship. You know, the sun, the moon, the stars, and all of these things that are not, they are evidences of the Lord, but they are not the power and the anointing of God as we know it and as we pray and as we feel. And you know, God's still working miracles today. If there's anybody here today, be sure and come up for prayer, because God does heal and he does work. And every place to go, every church I've been in, they have, even we have visited a Presbyterian church in our area, and they give testimonies of healing in that church, because it's people, it's the people that pray and ask the Lord. I've had, in the middle of the night, that's when I seem to feel the worst, and that's when the Lord ministers to me the most, because I have to call on him. And a few times I thought, well, this is it, you know, I can't stand it anymore. And then the Lord will come in and just pour his blessings. Have you ever noticed that? Have you ever had it work in your life? You do when you reach out to the Lord. We have known the Stovers for many years, and we have another friend here, Jerry Johnson and Linda, who came from Kansas City just this weekend to be with us, and they were so precious in our church through the years. God bless you, Jerry. God bless you. He brought us to Kansas City when he was living in Kansas City, and we had an absolutely wonderful meeting because we pastored in Kansas City. And so many of the people came out, and he's kept in touch with us. But Jerry is not only a good person, he's a worker, and he's gone in overseas missions. That's where he met his wife, in Japan, working for the Lord and missions over there. And so working for the Lord and giving of ourselves where is he that was talking about the offering, you know, give your offering, give yourself too, and your talents and your time, because you cannot give God in that. See, the Lord blesses you, and he blesses you, and he blesses you until you're overflowing. And that's what I was praying about what happened this morning. I know there's people, we're all smiling, we all seem happy, but you never know what's inside. You never know the heartache that might be going on. You never know what the hurts that have happened. And we have to understand that people show a good picture. They show a beautiful picture on the outside, but they are hurting. And those are the songs I'd like to sing for you this morning. And I pray that they'll be a blessing to you. God bless you.
Promised, and so much more. Lord. Nancy's got another song. I want her to sing at the end. I want her singing at the beginning, but after that song, you can't top that. Hallelujah. Woo! Praise the Lord. Let's give the Lord just a great big hand of praise this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Let's do it one more time. That felt good. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Yes. Amen. This is a nostalgic time for us. I'm probably better known as the fossil of the Full Gospel Fellowship of the world today. And the Will Rogers, they call me, because I tell so many stories. But Jesus was the greatest storyteller of all. I learned from him. Amen. It's a supreme joy and honor to be here with the Stovers and Lou Grillo. I knew Lou Grillo before he was a baby. And to be here with George and Sharon Stover, lifelong friends. And then, you know, you think it can't get any better. I come and meet people here like Brother John, offering all the time, good all the time. It's good all the time. God's good all the time. And your cook, is that Brother John the cook? Who is the cook? Barbecue yesterday. Yeah. Everything delightful and electrical. You just can't get any better than seeing some of you and Pastor and Sharon Stover, George and Sharon Stover. And then that little frosting on the tip of the iceberg, Jerry Johnson and Linda show up from Missouri, Japan. He comes through Missouri to Japan. And did you fly from Japan this time or just from Missouri? And they show up. And I think how great heaven's going to be, amen, when we all get together. What a great time. And my brother who takes the offering, you do such a great job. But I know you're not from New York City with that accent. I've been where you've been. I don't know. One of those countries. You have so many talented people here. And Camille, do all the good work. All of you back there. I start calling names, I'll miss somebody. But it's a privilege to be here and to share with you what the Lord has for us. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Lord, I stand in awe of your mercy and your grace and your miracles. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord. Strength and my Redeemer. And as we speak your word, you said if you're lifted up, you'll draw all men unto you. We lift you up today. Let your word go forth as a hammer, as balm, as oil to every needy heart and life here today. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for all that you are, for being with us today. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. And all the people said, amen. Amen. I had a friend, his name was Ernie Esklund. He was musical Esklunds. He was the best. Tomorrow night, I'm going to be preaching on this topic. He would take 29 minutes to announce his sermons for the next night, and he'd preach 25 minutes. And I said, Ernie, after I got established in the ministry, I said, if I had the money, I'd give you $1,000 a week just to announce my sermons tomorrow night. He did such a great job. One time he said, I'm going to do something that's never been done before. And he ate a peanut. Never been done before. When he said, I'm going to play my trombone backwards. I play the trombone. I thought, I got to see this. He turned around and faced the other way. He was so great. Well, I'm not going to trick you, but I'm going to announce tonight. I'm going to tell you a most unusual, remarkable, miracle story about how I went from Kansas City, Independence, Missouri, when I was called to come to Las Vegas, I think I had $12 cash in my pocket. Could you turn me up just a little bit? My voice is a little bit weak from my stress from last Sunday, I think. And when I arrived in Las Vegas, I had about $6 left. Now, how's that possible? I'm going to tell you this story tonight, how it happened. Truly a miracle. And that's some other stories, too, perhaps. You can say that my message today is about nobody. Let's look at the book first. Luke, the 6th division, the 19th verse. Whole multitudes sought to touch him, for they went virtue out of him, and he healed them all. Let me lay some more foundation. Let's look at the book again in the 8th division of Luke. We're going to see a picture here of the woman who was absolutely, positively nobody. I'm going to begin reading in the 42nd to the 48th verse. Next, I'll begin the 44th. There went a woman who wanted to be healed. And she came up behind and touched him, Jesus, of course, for she had been slowly bleeding for 12 years and could find no cure, though she had spent everything she had on doctors. But the instant she touched the edge of the hem of his garment, his robe, the bleeding stopped. "Who touched me?" Jesus asked. "Who touched me?" Everyone denied it, and Peter said, "Master, they're crowding against you, pushing and shoving, etc." But Jesus told him, "No, it was somebody who deliberately touched me, for I felt healing power go out of me." When the woman realized that Jesus knew, she began to tremble and fell on her knees. And she knew that she was healed. And Jesus said, Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace. Did you know that women couldn't vote until President Wilson was president of America in the early 1900s. And women of the Bible knew absolutely, positively nothing about voting. They had no rights, if any. Men could get a divorce simply by saying, "I want a male heir and you can't give it to me, so goodbye." Any excuse he could conjure up, women's gone. They had to either move back with their family or they had to go out on the street to make a living. By the way, ladies, please, please be sure that you vote on election day. Everybody turn to somebody and say, "Women are supposed to vote on election day." Go ahead. Please vote. During my ministry, I have talked to countless men, women, boys, and girls who believe Satan's lie that they would always be nobody. And way down deep in their innermost recesses of their heart, they believed and they felt like they were nobody, never going to be anybody. Take another look at the book in Micah 7:8. It says, "Though I have fallen, I will rise. Though I sit in darkness, the Lord shall be my light." Women had few rights, if any, as I said. Nobody going no place. This woman was a nobody. Totally, absolutely nobody. I'd like to go back a little bit and give my testimony, my childhood, because I started out world's view as nobody. You're looking at Bill Sharp this morning. Bill William Martin Sharp, but I wasn't always William Martin Sharp. So what happened? I got divorced, changed my last name? No. That's not my daughter. That's my wife over there, Nancy. I was born out of wedlock, given my father's first name and my mother's, biological mother's, last name. When I was born, I was named Rex Moore. I was placed in a orphan's home, was adopted. My name was changed from Rex Moore to Billy Martin Alexander, Martin after my foster grandfather. Then, because my foster mother divorced Mr. Alexander, she had had two husbands before and had a biological daughter. Before she met Mr. Alexander, she met Mr. Sharp. Then my name was changed from Rex Moore, Bill Alexander, to Bill Sharp, Billy Martin Sharp. Actually, I thought my middle name was No-No the first two or three years I lived. All I could hear was Billy No-No, Billy No-No, don't do this, don't. And then I went to an orphan's home for a while. I'm not sure why I went in the boys' home, why they put me there. I think I was in there twice. And then when I was about 13, I believe, 12 or 13, my foster mother married a man by the name of Lewis, Joseph Warren Lewis. And he was a nice man, and I overheard him talking with my mom, and he said, you know, I think I'll adopt Billy. Well, that meant I'm going to be Billy Martin Lewis. I don't want to be Billy Martin Lewis. I've already been Rex Moore, Bill Alexander, Billy Sharp. Now you're going to make me Billy Martin Lewis. What else am I going to be? So I fixed myself a peanut butter sandwich and took a banana and put it in a sack, went out to the railroad yard in Dallas, jumped on a freight train, and it was going to Oklahoma. I didn't know that. And I didn't know either that there was a hobo on the train in the boxcar asleep. Woke up when I got, how many, you know what a hobo is? Hobo is a hippie's father. And he wanted to eat my banana and my peanut butter sandwich. So I shared it with him, but I didn't want to give him the whole lunch. So I got off at Ardmore, Oklahoma. And got picked up by the Oklahoma police because I was in a bad neighborhood. And they said, where are you going? I said, I'm going home. Where do you live? I live up the road there where I saw a house with a light. Took me up there. I was pretty brazen. I do remember going up on the porch. One of the officers followed me. I knocked on the door. And a lady comes to the door, very nice, big smile. But several children looking around behind her, and one of them came over and grabbed my leg. And I said, I'm home. And she said, honey, child, you don't belong to me. Ain't no white folks live in this house. So they naturally took me away. And I I wound up in the jail that night, not locked up, but playing with handcuffs and bullets. Excuse me. And then I was taken by the Texas Rangers back to Dallas. My mother, whenever I get in trouble, which is quite often, she would lay over on the bed in a crucifix, and she would say, oh my God, oh my God. What have I done to deserve a son like this? And my grandmother would stand next to her, and she'd fan her with a Bible or dictionary. And I would walk in. My line was real short. Is there anything wrong? And ironically, the night I felt my call to the ministry, she also laid home. But she laid face down, and she had her arms out. My God, thank you. What have I done to deserve a son like this? Interesting how it changed. When I was 15 years old, typical, 15-year-old, well, I'm getting a little bit ahead of my story. Let me back up. I was about 11 years old. New Year's Eve, church, watched night service. Grew up to the drugstore with one of my friends and named Jim. We're sitting there. I said, Jim, let's make a New Year's resolution. What is it? From now on, let's resolve we're going to drink our coffee black. Jim said, Billy, we don't even drink coffee. I said, I know, but we're making a resolution to drink it. We're going to drink it black. February, he called me. He said, Billy, I broke my resolution. What do you mean? He said, I can't drink coffee black. I don't like it. I'll have to have sugar and cream. Well, we got to be 12 years old. We wanted to be somebody. We thought we'd be somebody by drinking coffee. That didn't work. But we're going to be somebody. And you know what we decided how we could be somebody? Because we saw some advertisements, even back then, that really make us somebody. That was to smoke a cigarette. And I had an experience. I told my buddy Jim when he was saying, I forget how we got the pack of cigarettes. I remember the brand, Lucky Strikes. Anybody remember those cigarettes? Oh, we got a lot of smokers here. Okay, delivered. I hope you're delivered. Anyway, I remember we got the cigarettes. Where are we going to hide them? I said, well, you can't hide them at my grandmother's house. I was living with her then because she's deaf, but she has a nose like an anteater. And I said, let me tell you what happened some weeks ago or months ago, however it was. I said, some guy after school had a cigarette and they were passing it around the circle. And I took a couple of puffs and I knew I smelled funny. I said, man, I smell funny. He said, don't worry, come over to my house. I'll fix you up. Your grandmother will never know you smoke. So when I got to his house, he said, here, eat some of this garlic. You ever eat a garlic, fresh garlic? Oh, I'm chewing the garlic. My tears coming down. I'm crying all the way home. When I got to the house, my grandmother was sweeping the porch. She saw me, and she said, why are you crying? I said, I'm not crying. Yes, you are. When I passed her, she said, you smell like garlic and tobacco. She hit me with a broom. I said, so we can't put the cigarettes in my house. Don't worry, he said, we'll put them in my house. My mother is a canner. She cans things. I'll put it up in the pantry, way back in a paper sack in one of the coffee cans, and she'll never find it. So we hid the cigarettes. By and by, it's time to go out and be somebody. We smoke our cigarette. So we got the cigarettes. Jimmy brought them. We went to the zoo. Went over to a place where nobody was around the zoo, took the cigarettes out of the sack, ready to smoke. We had matches. I don't know where we got the matches. We looked at the cigarettes, but something had happened. Those of you that have smoked, you know they have a little cellophane thing. You unravel it at the top, take the cellophane off, then you tear the pack open. Well, the cellophane had been taken off. Cigarettes were intact, still sealed. But on each side of the cellophane, there was a little piece of paper folded. What's that? Pulled it out. The wages of sin is death. The gift of God is in it. Be not mocked, God. You know, boy. Jimmy says, I'm going to get killed. My daddy's going to kill me when he gets home. They know about the sin. They never, Mrs. Hicks never said a word. Even at her funeral, I preached her funeral. I brought that up. Until years later, she confessed it. My daddy's going to kill me. His daddy was a big guy, about 6'2", 300 pounds, and he would hold us, grab us, wrestle us, and throw us on the bed. And one time I remember we were wrestling. I said, Jimmy, I know how we can get your daddy down. How? I said, let's take off his leg. I'll take his leg off. What do you mean? He's got a wooden leg, hasn't he? Yeah. When you get him in the front, I'll get in the back, unstrap his leg, take it off. We did, throw him over, got him on the bed, and he yelled out as he went down, Billy, you're the dirtiest fighter I've ever known. You know? But cigarettes, we didn't smoke. We never got to smoke. I think we sold them to somebody in the woods. I don't know. 17 years old, I'm going to be somebody. Finally, I'm going to join the Marines. You know, got to be a man. That was okay. Swear us in. We get to the boot camp. And you know what the DI said? How many have been in the service? You've been in the military. Okay. First thing the DI said, you're not Marines yet. And you're not civilians either. And then he said the classic phrase, you're nobody. Big deal. I go all the way to the Marine Corps and find out I'm still nobody. But when I was 15 years old, before that, a woman evangelist talked to Brother George Stover about this. Her name was Clara Grace. My pastor had a lot of lady evangelists. She came to the church and she was praying over people and prophesying over the church and people. And one Sunday night, we were sitting on the back row, all of us teenagers, and she gets off the platform. The church was seated about 1,000 people, and it was full. She walked down the aisle all the way, halfway down, started praying over people. So we knelt down, and we're watching her, you know, but we're on our knees, seeing what's going to happen. And all of a sudden, she was just without 5 rows of us. Oh, you know, God. But then she turned around. Walk away. Thank you, Lord. She's walking away. Thank you. Not going to mess with us. Then she just stopped like she heard something. And she turned around. She comes over, you know, and lays in. And those were, anybody ever use hair oil? Anybody that old? No, I don't guess so. Well, I used hair oil and had a big wave up there. I was going to go out with a tall girl that night, you know, and I was trying to get tall. And she goes, getting the oil, flattened my pompadour, whatever it was. And she started prophesying. And she said, your mother's womb, Jesus knew who you were. And you're nobody now. Well, I'm not nobody. You have to remind me of that. But you're going to take my gospel to the four corners of the earth. And you'll preach all over. I wound up preaching the four corners of the earth in Korea at the world's largest church there many years later. And I held up my boots that I wore at that time, and I said, I came here years ago as a Marine. I wore these boots, and I held up a scabbard. I didn't have anything in it. I said, in here I had a holster. This holster held a pistol. And I said, I came as a representative of the United States government, a Marine. But I said, I come tonight in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and I'm holding up my weapon, the word of the living God. And my sword is also in this book. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. And I had a chance to go back and see families, members of that dear lady years later to confirm what she has said to me. Nobody. But you got to be somebody when you get married. So I married. You know already by just looking at Nancy, I overmarried. Who said amen? Did somebody say amen? Pastor Silver? So I got married. I want to be somebody for her. And she came from a very nice home. I already told you enough about my background. And I got a nice apartment, had a little upright piano where you make things, you know, as nice as I could for her. Wasn't too long, and I didn't realize when you write checks, you're supposed to have money. We both thought, just write the checks till you use them all, you know. And I had to move out of that nice apartment to a third floor attic apartment, no air condition, a fan that burned out in about a month. We didn't have anything to eat, got down to nothing, waiting for a GI check to help us go into school, trying to get a job or keep jobs. It was awful, terrible. And we were living on hot chocolate and toast for several days. And I went down an alley, walked down the stairs, walking down this alley, and I began to pray. And the devil was saying, you're worse than an infidel. The word of God says, you've got to take care of your family. You're worse than an infidel. You don't even have anything to get it. Quit this messing around. My father-in-law kept wanting me to go to work for him. Call your father-in-law. Take the job in Detroit. Go to work in the factory. Be somebody. You're nobody. You're nobody. You're nobody. Nobody. I'm walking down the alley. Really, God, I need a sign. I need something to prove to me that you're going to be there. I know you haven't left me, but some kind of sign, anything. As I'm walking down the alley, suddenly I look, and by the way, I met somebody, before I tell you this story, 2 years ago out on the strip, and they said, do you remember your sermon, your first sermon you preached in Las Vegas? I said, I don't have a clue. They said, I do, and they told me this story, and I'm going to tell it to you. And it's a story that when I preached for Full Gospel Businessmen, they always say, tell the ace in the alley story. I said, tell that. Tell it again, because it's a miracle story. There in the alley were four eggs, two tan ones, two white ones. Guess who the tan ones are for? I picked up the four eggs. I come running up the steps. As I come up to the top of that little apartment, I smell the most delightful smell my old proboscis had ever smelled. Bacon and bread. Nancy was cooking, sizzling. Bacon was cooking in the skillet. Wow. Where did you get the bacon? Where did you get the bread? Where did you get the eggs? Tell me your story first, because you're not going to believe mine. Well, the landlady went out to the country, the farm or whatever, brought back bacon, brought back some bread, wanted to share it with us. Hallelujah. I said, well, I'm walking down the alley, minding my own business, talking to God, and all of a sudden these eggs showed up. Later I went down looking around, no hen house. I could never find a hen house, never find any chickens, never saw any. Went down the next day, four eggs. Went down the next day, 7 days I went down there, four eggs every day. We had eggs scrambled, we had them poached, we had them fried, we had them Rockefeller, however kind you, any way you can have them. We had four eggs a day. GI check comes in. Nancy says, honey, let's go to, you know, the restaurant and have breakfast. Woman, we don't need to go to the breakfast. I got eggs in the alley. Seventh is the eighth day. Well, okay. I go out. Guess what? No eggs. Now, how many believe that God supplied ravens to feed Elijah? How many believe that? Okay. How many believe my egg story? Yeah, I don't know where the eggs come from. Did they come from heaven? I don't think so. Most likely somebody went and put them in the alley. But why did they do it for 7 days and it wasn't even near my apartment. It was down two blocks away. Why? I don't know. Was somebody looking out a window to see who picked him up? I don't know. I don't question it. But from that moment on, I knew that my God will supply all of my needs according to his riches and glory through Christ Jesus our Lord. Can you say the amen? Hallelujah. Now, the Old Testament women, they couldn't be prophets, but they could be prophets, I'm sorry, but they couldn't be priests because of their monthly cycle. Neither could a woman legally testify in a court of law. Most women couldn't read. In the New Testament, they were told to keep silent in the church. Try that today. And if you look at the book, when you get home, Leviticus, the 15th division, 25th to the 30th verse, you can see what it says about the lady's sickness and why she couldn't even worship in the temple. Only a leper was worse off than this lady. She couldn't worship. She was nobody. Get that picture. She was nobody. I want to read you a poem that a blind poet gave us, written by a blind poet, given to my sister-in-law who gave it to me. It says, "It's pointless what I do or say. Nobody is listening anyway. Discouraged by the hand I'm dealt, I know just how she must have felt. She was nobody, too. A time when women knew their place and scarcely dared to show their face. If you had not been born a man, how could God use you in his great plan? To the world, she was nobody. A disgrace to her family name, a source of sorrow, guilt, and shame. This curse must be a result of sin without the curse within. To her family, she was nobody. From neighbors and the family friends, insults and loathing had no ends. Don't talk to her. Just say away the hurting things that they would say. To her neighbors, she was nobody. The doctors who had seen her tears and treated her a dozen years made no improvement in her health. The only change, her loss of wealth. To her doctors, she was nobody." And so what happened that day? Jesus said, he said, "Somebody touched me." And you read, and you know the scenario. And by the way, he knew who touched him. And she knew who touched what had happened, because she felt the miracle. Peter says, "Everybody, Lord, Master, everybody's touching you. It could be everybody, anybody." He says, no. It's not anybody. It's not everybody. He said, it was somebody. Somebody touched me. And he said, "The crowds are pressing you." Jesus says, "I know the crowd. I know they're touching me, but somebody else touched me." In the translation we have here, "Someone deliberately touched me." Another translation, "I felt virtue come out of me." Another translation, "Someone has made a demand on my ability." It was like Jacob of old who said, "I'll not let you go. I'll not let you go until you bless me." This woman was saying, "If I can touch him." And this portrays her in one translation, the original, it portrays her this way. She didn't just say, "If I could touch him," but as she was clawing her way through the crowd, she was saying, "If I can but touch him, if I can but touch him, if I can just touch him, if I can just touch him, I know I'll be made whole." I believe that's significant to us today. We've got a purpose in our heart. We're not going to quit. We're going to keep saying, "I'm going to touch the Lord. I'm going to receive my blessing. I'm going to know God's going to answer my prayer." Can you say the amen? Hallelujah. Over and over and over and over, I know if I can touch him, everything's going to change. And I believe this morning, if you need to touch Jesus, everything will change for you. Because you can't touch Jesus. Listen to me. You can't touch Jesus and be a nobody. You can't touch him and be a nobody. Once you touch him, you know Pastor Stover's testimony. I didn't know this for years, that they didn't believe in the gospel. They never heard a gospel message. And they didn't think so, but they were nobody. But once they touched Jesus, and ever since, because of that, they're somebody. And you've got pastors here who are somebodies because they touched Jesus. Hallelujah. Give the Lord a hand of praise. Glory to God. Glory to God. Somebody touched him, and they're never the same again, you see. This is the rest of this poem. She broke the law just being there. Unclean, not welcome anywhere. But she had heard He'd healed a few and knew that he could heal her too, even if she was a nobody. The healing power that flowed from him, but with a curse, her future dim. If she could touch his garment fair, he'd never notice she was there because she was nobody. When she, through faith, reached out her hand, a rush of power left that man. "Who touched me?" was his first reply. Then Peter glanced, and with a sigh, he said, "It was nobody." The master begged to disagree. "I know somebody did touch me. Despite what she had been before, she wasn't nobody anymore." I want to say that again. She wasn't nobody anymore. If all it takes faith, I can be somebody too. With faith, we can all be somebody. Can you say the amen? James 4:10 says what? "Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up." Nobody is somebody when you come to Jesus. Anybody is somebody when you touch Jesus. Everybody is somebody when you touch Jesus. You can't touch Jesus. I want to reiterate and stay a nobody. Hallelujah. 1 Peter 2:10, "Once you were less than nothing, but now you are God's own." Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hey, listen, the devil wants to count you out. He wants you to believe you're still a nobody. But Jesus said, "You touched me." And God has never given up on or the esteem for you. I want you to know that this morning. You may be down on yourself. And you may be down and out. But just touch Jesus and you're going to come out of it. Amen. God values you. Say, "God values me." Everybody. You may condemn yourself or others may be condemning you. But God will only lift you up. Jeremiah 33:3 says, "Call upon me. Call upon me and I'll answer you and I'll do great and mighty things that you know not." Hallelujah. You have to just believe God. God will only lift you up. He says you're somebody created in his own image. And Satan says you're still nobody. The devil is trying to tell you you can't make it. Can't make it. You're not going to make it. You are a loser. You're a loser. You made too many mistakes. Made too many mistakes. Messed up too much. Messed up too much. You have to take life's journey sitting down. You got to sit in the back of the bus. Well, you just need to tell the devil, your heavenly Father owns the bus company and Jesus is driving your bus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I believe Jesus is saying right now to somebody, "You're touching me." Hallelujah. Somebody is being can receive their healing. Somebody can be delivered this morning. Somebody can come home this morning. Somebody's marriage can be made right again. Somebody that's hurting can be made well. Somebody crying out lonely, you can not be lonely anymore. You don't have the right finances. Touch Jesus. He said, "I'll supply all of your needs according to the riches in glory of Christ Jesus our Lord." Oh, hallelujah. Glory to God. That's enough to make an Egyptian mummy shout. Somebody say the amen. I got to tell you about one more nobody. Can I tell you one more story? You won't leave, will you? Nobody. This is a nobody. I want to write a book someday. Say, "Whoever heard of Effie Nee?" Nobody. But her family, Nancy, heard of her. She was a little lady, come along, cleaned house, went to church. Got in touch with Nancy when she was a little girl. Brought her to church. Before long, Nancy was standing up on the stool, chair, singing. There's a welcome here in church service. Her little sister started coming. Effie brought both of them. By and by, got Mama to come. By and by, Daddy came. And they all became powerful witnesses for God. She never married. All she did is hang out in church. I don't know if she ever read a newspaper or watched TV. She prayed, fasted, prayed. Just a little maiden lady. One night she's coming home on the bus from church. Just she and another man were on the bus. She gets off. She has to walk across the park to get to her place where she's living. The man gets off the bus when she gets off the bus. And she, out of the corner of her eye, she can see he's following her. He goes faster, faster. He pursues her, grabs her, throws her to the ground, starts to tear her clothes off. Puts one hand over her mouth, and she's thinking as she gives this testimony, if I could just say Jesus, if I could just speak his name, I could get this man off of me. And then to tear her foundations away, he took his hand away from her mouth. And then when he did that, she said, oh, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. There's power in the name of Jesus. Is there not?
Amen.
Hallelujah. There's power in the name of Jesus. And when she said Jesus, she said, suddenly I looked around the park, and there, circling the park, were angels like with 30-foot wingspread, just surrounding the whole park. Oh, she was hallucinating, of course, right? But what about this? The man jumped up and he said, get him away from me, get him away from me, get him away from me. And he ran out of the park. You read in Psalms 91:11, he shall give his angels charge over you, guard over you, to keep you in all your ways. Can you say the amen? Oh, hallelujah. Give the Lord a clap offering this morning. Somebody touch him this morning. Somebody can touch him. You can touch him for your need, whoever you are. Oh, hallelujah. Bow your heads with me for just a moment. Lord, we look to you today, the beginning and the ending of our faith. Someone needs to touch you this morning. We know that they'll never be the same. Never be the same. Never be the same. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just remain seated where you are. Nancy's going to come and sing this song. I'm dedicating it to every one of you that need the Lord this morning. Oh, hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. People need the Lord. People need the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Hallelujah. With your heads bowed, just listen to the words of this song. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Oh, we love you, Jesus. We praise your name. Mighty God, awesome God. You've never failed us. Never failed us. Never failed us yet. Praise God. Lord, we need you, Lord. We need you today. We need you today. Hallelujah.
Every day,
yes,
I sleep on, I can see it in their eyes. Empty people. What could be to free a heart?
Yes. Lord, we need you this morning. We need to touch the hem of your garment.
People need the Lord.
We need to put our hand in the nail-scarred hand.
At the end, the broken dreams, he's the open door. People need the Lord. People need.
Deuteronomy 33:12, let the beloved of the Lord rest secure in him, for he shields you all day long. The one the Lord loves rests between his shoulders. The love of your life right now needs to be Jesus. But all the hurts and the disappointments and the betrayals that you have felt, you need to put behind you and touch Jesus afresh and anew, as he's given you charge over these little ones. And you have a very important role. And the enemy would make you feel like you're nobody, because in my mind I've seen that you've been forsaken from something. But he says, hey Lord, come with me, all you that are weary and heavy laden. Give you rest. I know what it's like to be lonely. I've been lonely, but not for a long, long time. Jesus, we touch you this morning. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We touch these little ones. They touch you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Blessing more than anything in her life. And I speak blessings upon you, prosperity upon you both, the work that you do. Hallelujah. But you haven't even scratched the surface of what God's going to have you do. There's a work for you to do, and I don't know what it is, but it may be far away, may be nearer. But God's hand is upon you to continue the work to do exceeding above all that you might ask or think. Hallelujah. 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 Would you rest? Just lift your hands and praise the Lord. Just say, when I touch you, say, Jesus, I touch you this morning. Jesus, I touch you for my need this morning. And speak whatever your need is. Jesus, I touch you for my need this morning. Hallelujah. Jobs are coming. Better things are coming. Better things are coming. Hallelujah. 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 Faithful, faithfulness is a good word for you. Hallelujah. Faithful. Faithful handmaiden. God's just beginning to get ready to crank you up, young man. Most people look up to you anyway. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But they're going to look up to you more, because they're going to be so so anointed and so full of the Holy Ghost that they're going to say, wow, that guy, where does he can hold a lot, I guess. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth, glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you for my brother this morning. Hallelujah. Minister to him, Lord. Fresh and anew. Fresh and anew. Everything that he needs, he desires. A big, heavy burden you're carrying. You don't need to carry that burden, whatever it is. It's weighing you down. You lift up. I want you to lift your hands up. Lift your heads up. Say, thank you, Lord. All the burden's gone. It's gone. Whatever that's been pushing on you, squeezing on you. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you. Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Lord, what you, you know what I feel like I want to do? I want Camille, my brother here, Lou, of course, Pastor Sharon, would you come? Everybody that's on staff, would you just come and stand in front of this line? Come, we're not through praying the other line, but if you're on staff or if you're working, I want you to come up here and just stand face me, please. Come and stand in front of this line. If you're an elder, deacon, or if you got some, you have a position in the church, come and just stand right there. Where's Pastor? There's like, Pastor, would you come, please? Pastor Snowba. Hallelujah. Just stand here, face me. Face me this way. Turn around this way. Face me. I want to pray for all of us. And I want you to be stretch your hands towards these people. Is this any other, everybody that's on the staff, come and stand here on the front line with Pastor. Pastor, stand over here with Sharon. What, stand there. This is your church. Stand where you want to. Hallelujah. What am I going to tell you where to stand? Okay, I want you to stretch your hands towards these. And I'm going to pray for them, for the fresh anointing and unity of the Holy Ghost to just rest upon them, that they'll be empowered to get this new building. And we're going to, you know what? I believe you're going to have to put an ad in the paper. Come early if you want a seat. I remember that years ago, some of the healing evangelists had these tents. When tents were popular, people would come and sit in the afternoon from 2 o'clock before the service started at 7, you know. And I believe you're going to say, come early if you want a seat in this place. Because signs and wonders, the greatest thing that attracted people to Jesus' ministry was the miracles. Miracles. I said that yesterday. We want to believe in the miraculous. God's a miracle working God. And God does, as you said right on this morning, he doesn't give increase. You've got to believe in increase. Say increase, everybody.
Increase.
Amen. Stretch your hands towards these precious servants. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth, we anoint them. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. We anoint them in Jesus' name. Each one of them, Lord, gifted and called to serve in this church, to serve you most first of all, oh God. Hallelujah. 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 In the name of Jesus, Lord, let that unique afflatus, that special anointing of the Holy Ghost rest upon them. Unify us, Lord, as believers. One mighty army going forth under a terrible banner. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Praise your name, Lord. Praise your name. Hallelujah. Now let's just give him praise for the work he's done. We thank you, Lord. We're not beggars. We're receivers this morning. Hallelujah. We're receivers this morning. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Sharon, can you play He Touched Me or anything close to that? Nancy, help sing He Touched Me as I anoint the rest of the folk here this morning. Hallelujah. He touched me. Oh, hallelujah. He's here to touch us, every one of us this morning in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Jesus' name. He touches me in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Anybody we didn't pray for that wants to be anointed this morning. Hallelujah. My brother here. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for this brother. Hallelujah. Things are just beginning to open up for you. Good things. You're on your way. You're on your way, whatever it means. Your goals are being accomplished. You've got some goals you're setting. It's coming together. It's coming together. Hallelujah. It's coming together. Hallelujah. He touched me. Just start with a chorus. He touched me. Oh, he touched me. Hallelujah. 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 And all the joy. Let's sing it again.
He touched me and made me. touched me. Oh, he touched me.
And come forward again. Come out of your pews and just stand in mass. Everybody, just stand right here. We're not going to pray for you again, but I just want you to feel something different. Come and stand here. Now, I want you to sing that song again. He touched me. And then just lift your hands and sing it unto the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
He touched me.
Hallelujah.
Oh, he touched me.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. You see the difference is when you come together, you feel close together. You're part of the army. When you're sitting in pews and chairs, overseas, a lot of people just sit on the floor. You know, they're all close together. Isn't it different when you're together, when you're close together? I'll tell you one more story real quick. I was in Peoria, Illinois, Easter. Nancy wasn't there. Walking home from the meeting, had a great meeting in Peoria. Staying at the YMCA, decided to take a shortcut, went in the wrong neighborhood. You know, burlesque, lights shining. I thought, I got to get out of this neighborhood. All of a sudden, three guys come up, and they're going to mug me. And I was carrying my attaché case. I had an overcoat on, a little kind of a Western hat. Stetson, and I guess I didn't do what I should have done. I should have prayed. Instead of praying, the guy came at me, and I hit him with a briefcase, kicked the other guy in the chin. I hit another guy. And I repented later. And then I ran down the street. I ran as fast as I could. And I got to the YMCA just as I was thinking, God, I'm at the YMCA. And I was telling God why I did this. You know, I was a Marine. And after all, he didn't want to hear a Sunday school lesson, did he? I mean, I just, you know, you took the whip. You know, you can always take a scripture. Isn't it amazing? Take the scripture and use it to excuse you for what you're doing. Jesus, you took a whip. You were, you know, I didn't have a whip. I used a briefcase. All of a sudden, a guy pulls up in a car and jumps out. I knew he was the one I dropkicked. He had his chin all scratched up. And he comes toward me, and he reaches in his pocket. He pulls out a .32 revolver. He says, I'm going to shoot you, you SOB. He cuts me out. And he cocks the hammer back. And he's as close as I am to you. I thought, I'm just not quite close enough to grab the gun. And then I thought, forget about grabbing the gun. Touch Jesus. And I said the same thing that Effie needed. Oh, I said, Jesus, Jesus. And he took the pistol and he said, now, like this. And he started shaking his hand and he took it and he said, this blanket blank thing won't shoot. Won't shoot. It won't. That hammer. I said, let me see. He handed me the gun. I want to shoot him in the foot, you know, Pastor. Bang, I'll shoot you now. It works. And I closed the hammer. I said, you need a drink. It was a towel house. He thought I meant a hoots-a-pooch. We went to the Tuttle House, had coffee. While we're having coffee, I said, I'm a minister. So, well, I've never been kicked to the chin by a minister. I said, did you ever try to shoot one before? You know, they're hard to kill. And all of a sudden, this woman walks in with a robe over her outfit. She had a hoochie-coochie outfit, a scriptural blouse, lo and behold. I mean, she was really, you know, she's an exotic dancer. She was... His wife, he just got out of prison. He was on probation. Wasn't supposed to be out late. Wasn't supposed to be drinking. Wasn't supposed to be carrying firearms, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So they came to church on Sunday morning, Easter Sunday. Came in late, had a Band-Aid on his chin, sit in the back. So I told the pastor the story. I said, well, at least they heard the gospel once. But that night they came back, came forward and accepted Jesus. I saw the pastor at a convention a couple of years later. Do you remember that story? Oh, he said, they're teaching the boys class now. A couple, you touch Jesus. If you just touch Jesus for this ministry here, get behind this ministry, support it, pray for it. Offerings all the time. Do what they tell you. Follow the laws, as I said yesterday. Follow the rules. God will bless this church abundantly. How many believe that? If you believe that, give the Lord one more clap off. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Hi, I'm Pastor George Stover, and I want to invite you to come and join with us as we build the kingdom of God at Wellspring Church of All Nations. We're located at 8140 West Lone Mountain Road. There's also an entrance off of 4870 Janelle Drive. There is nothing more important to you and I today than the Word of God. If we don't learn as a people, as a nation, to return to the Bible, to return to faith in Jesus Christ and Him alone, we're not going to have the country that we've had, the one that I grew up in. I want my grandchildren and my children, your children and your grandchildren to live in the America I grew up in. But you know, it's going to depend on us, the people of faith. We have to get into the Word and just stick with it. And having done all, stand. And so we're really, really wanting you to come and just be a part of who we are, what we're doing here, because it's really all about you.